Well, as the great Borat once said, wawawiwa. We had an insane end to the 2019 MLB trade deadline. For a while, it was pretty calm. It felt almost dead. There wasn't a whole lot of juice going around. A lot of rumors, but no trades being made. 4 o'clock hit, you thought it was done. And then Ken Rosenthal drops this. The Houston Astros dropped the mic. They, without a doubt, made the biggest move of the 2019 MLB trade deadline. The Houston Astros traded for Zach Greinke, something that I don't think anyone really even saw coming. So in today's video, I'm gonna go over the Zach Greinke trade. I'm also gonna talk about the Bauer trade and a few others that happened as well. Tomorrow, I plan to put out my grades on every single team and trade that happened at the deadline. So if you're looking for something a little more in depth, that's gonna be going on tomorrow. But today we're gonna focus on the big trades. As always, if you guys do enjoy this video, make sure to leave a like on it. That's the best way to show your support. Subscribe if you're new and you enjoy the content. This is actually the first video I'm recording since I hit 100K. Thank you all so much. I can't tell you how much I appreciate the amazing support you guys have shown me since the baseball season started. And in the month of July, it's been absolutely incredible. So thank you so much for that. Remember to get in the comment section down below. Let me know what you think about this trade or any trade you want to talk about down in the comments. Make sure to let me know what you think. Make sure to follow me on Twitter and Instagram at GiraffeNeckMark. Links are in the description. You're going to want to follow me. I'm doing some giveaways over there to thank you guys for 100K subs. So if you want to win some free stuff, check them out. And of course, if you want to buy any tickets to sports games, make sure to head on over to SeatGeek and use the code Giraffe at checkout to save yourself $20 off your first purchase. So like I said, the Astros made a huge, huge move at the deadline. They traded for Zach Greinke, who, let's be honest, there was rumors that he was going to be traded. We weren't sure where he would necessarily go. He does have some issues with anxiety, so he typically stays away from big market teams. He did have a no trade clause for about half the league, but the Astros were not a team on it, and the Astros pounced on that opportunity to get Zach Greinke. The rumors for what feels like the past week have maybe been Thor, maybe Wheeler, maybe Stroman, maybe some of these other smaller name guys that they would go after in the starting pitching market, but they went out and they went big. I don't think we can underplay how big of a move this is for the Houston Astros. This is massive for the American League playoff landscape this season. So here are the details of the trade. The Houston Astros get Zach Greinke, and the Diamondbacks get back a bunch of prospects. They get back Seth Beer, who's the number 3 prospect in the Astros organization. He makes it in the top 100. They also get JB Bukauskas, who's the number 4 prospect in the Astros organization, a pitcher. They get Corbin Martin, who's the number 5 prospect, and they also got Josh Rojas, who's one of their mid-level prospects in the 20s. The Astros also received $24 million from the Diamondbacks in order to help pay Zach Greinke's contract. So first, let's talk about the Arizona Diamondbacks here. I like the move a lot. Zach Greinke's really not a part of your future. You technically still are competing. They went out and traded for Mike Leake earlier in the day, so they were definitely trying to get better. They weren't complete sellers. But the Zach Greinke contract really didn't make sense for them to have anymore. Zach Greinke's getting up there in age. He's not really a part of the future. While he still is a very solid pitcher and probably will be for the next few years because he really does know how to pitch. He understands what it takes to be a top pitcher in the game. It just doesn't make sense for Arizona to be paying all that money to an aging starter. So you get a lot of the money of his off the books, which allows them to be a little bit more free in spending money in free agency, maybe spending on some of their younger guys, give them extensions, who knows. And they get back a lot of really good young talent. So the first and highest ranked prospect they got was Seth Beer, who, like I said, was the number 3 prospect in the Astros and 100th overall in MLB. He's a first base outfielder, but he really profiles more as a first baseman. Big power bat, doesn't run well, doesn't field well. Got 25 home runs, 7 doubles on the season in minor league baseball, just driving in runs, hitting for a high average, slugging percentage high, OPS high. His on-base percentage is above 400. He looks like he could be a solid first baseman for the Diamondbacks in the future. JB Bukauskas seems like he's also going to be a solid starter. 22 years old, drafted back in 2017. Double A this year, he has run into a little bit of trouble. His ERA, his whip, it's all a little bit higher than you'd like to see. And walks have really been a big problem for him. But he sits mid-90s. He has a power slider. He throws a nice cutter. He's definitely a solid pitcher and can help be a part of that Arizona Diamondbacks future. Corbin Martin's in a similar scenario. Now, he did undergo Tommy John surgery recently, so he's going to miss quite some time. But he came up for the Astros this year. Another guy drafted back in 2017 who's just flown through the minor league system. The Astros know what to do with pitchers. Throws absolute heat, sitting in the high 90s. His slider curveball combination is really solid. He's a good pitcher as well. You got to see what he's like when he comes back from Tommy John, but overall he looks like he could be very solid for the Diamondbacks. And then Josh Rosas is a 25-year-old kind of utility player. He can play second base, a little bit of the corner outfield. He's hit really well in the minors this year. He has over 50 extra base hits thus far in the season. He's hitting for a high average. He's tearing the cover off the ball. So I think the Diamondbacks got a nice little haul back for a guy in Zach Greinke that they're honestly not going to use, and they got a lot back for him. Now for the Astros, you got Zach Greinke, who is quietly having one of the better seasons of his career ERA wise. He has an ERA below 3 this year at 2.9, 10-4 record in 22 starts. He's got a whip under 1 at 0.943. He's walking virtually nobody. He's still striking out batters at a pretty good rate, not giving up a lot of hits, not giving up a lot of the long ball. Zach Greinke was an all-star. He's just having a really good year. And now you add him to that Astros team, who, by the way, was already one of the favorites in the American League. Now they add Zach Greinke, they have to be the favorite. I mean, the Yankees didn't do anything, really. The Indians went out and made some nice moves. We'll talk about that. But the Astros went ahead and said, yeah, guess what? We're the best team now. You have to come through us. You have to beat us. Because this starting rotation is unbelievable. You got Justin Verlander out there. You got Garrett Cole. You got Zach Greinke. I don't know if there's a better 1-2-3 in Major League Baseball. The Nationals have some competition with Scherzer, Strasburg, Corbin. The Mets now have a really good 1-2-3 where you go DeGrom, Thor, Stroman, or you throw Wheeler in there, whichever one you want to go with. The Indians are stacked with their rotation, even trading Trevor Bauer. Same thing with the Dodgers. They have a great rotation. It's hard to argue right now that anybody has a better 1-2-3 than the Astros. Think about in the ALDS. You have to go through Verlander, Cole, and Greinke. And oh yeah, Wade Miley is also having a fantastic year with an ERA right around 3. They have Greinke for 2020. They have him for 2021. And right now, there's no signs of him really slowing down. He's pitching at an ace-like level. This is just such an incredibly good move for the Houston Astros. I don't know who can beat them now in the American League. Yes, the Yankees have that crazy powerful lineup, but their pitching just doesn't match up. The Astros have a really good bullpen to begin with. Yankees is better, but the Astros is still very strong. Now they got that other starting pitcher. I mean, we thought they were going to go for Wheeler, maybe a lower tier guy, and say, yeah, that would still be a nice pickup. And then they're like, boom, Zach Greinke. How about that? Oh yeah, and we grab Joe Biagini, and we grab Aaron Sanchez to help out that bullpen even more. I really like this move for the Houston Astros. For those of you who are watching my stream, you saw my reaction when I read it. I was like, What? Like, it literally blew my mind because nobody was talking about Greinke to the Astros. It felt like it was Greinke to the Phillies, Greinke to some other teams, but nobody was saying the Astros. He ends up going there and he makes one of the best teams in baseball pretty much go right to the top now. That team is stacked. The offense is loaded. Starting pitching is loaded. Bullpen is loaded. Barring any major injuries, how does this team lose? So for the Houston Astros and the Houston Astros fans, you should be ecstatic. Unbelievable job by the front office there. You gotta be happy. And then really the other big trade of the deadline, there was a Shane Green trade, but that wasn't really that big. I mean, he was a good piece, but the Tigers didn't get much back. And again, I'll go over more of that tomorrow. But the other one that a lot of people wanted to talk about is the Trevor Bauer trade. So Trevor Bauer was traded to the Cincinnati Reds. Indians got Yasiel Puig, they got Franmil Reyes, they got Logan Allen, and then they got two prospects as well. And the Padres got Taylor Trammell. There's a lot to talk about with this trade as well. First off, the Reds dump off Yasiel Puig, who they're not going to use. They weren't going to re-sign him. He's a free agent at the end of the season. And in my opinion, they got pretty good value off of him, considering they got him from LA for pretty much nothing. And now they get to flip him for Trevor Bauer, who's going to help that rotation in 2019 and in 2020. Because he's not a free agent until after the 2020 season. And while Trevor Bauer is a bit of a head case, I mean, he definitely has a screw or two loose up there, and he does like to throw the ball over the fence in center field, which is still an unbelievable feat. I don't feel like enough people are talking about how crazy far he threw that ball, because, you know, he's nuts in the head. But he's a really solid pitcher. There's no way around it. The dude works hard. It's not like he's someone who's lazy. He's just a little crazy. But now you got him. You got Sonny Gray leading that rotation. That's a nice little 1-2 punch there in Cincinnati. You did give up Taylor Trammell to the Padres, which hurts a little bit, but the Reds have a pretty decent farm system. And if you're going to keep rocking Nick Senzel in center, I mean, that's kind of your move. Padres getting Taylor Trammell. I was shocked. I was really surprised with how much they traded. They traded a couple prospects. They traded Logan Allen. They traded Franmil Reyes. All guys who have been pretty much like part of that team this year. They've been pretty useful. Logan Allen, I can understand a little bit, but Franmil Reyes really surprised me. I thought that Hunter Renfroe might have gone before Franmil Reyes because of the age difference. They're basically the same player, big power hitting guys. So I was very shocked when I saw Franmil Reyes' name included in this trade. He hits for crazy power. He has a slugging percentage above 500. Anytime you're above 500, that's elite power. You want to knock him, he doesn't walk enough and he strikes out a little bit too much. Yeah, sure, he doesn't hit for a high average, but he's only 24 years old and you have control over him until 2025. So to give him, Logan Allen, and a couple other guys up just pretty much for Taylor Trammell felt a little bit, I don't know, I just wasn't really on the same page as them. But if they're high on Taylor Trammell being their center fielder of the future, even though they do have Manuel Margot, but he's not great, then I guess it was worth it for them because their corner outfield spot definitely is crowded if there's a position there that they have a lot of corner outfield. Now for the Indians, definite winners of this trade. Some people are going to say they gave up Bauer. How do you give up pitching when you're trying to compete for the AL Central title? The Indians are loaded with pitching, let me tell you that. Carlos Carrasco will be back from the IL any day soon, which is just great news in general because obviously he was suffering from leukemia. Glad to see that he's doing better. But it's also great news for the Indians because he's a really good pitcher. He's an all-star caliber guy. They're putting Danny Salazar right back into the rotation, who in the past has had really good years, but he started to be a little bit shaky last year. So if he can return to his old form, you don't really miss Trevor Bauer. Shane Bieber's been fantastic. You got Corey Kluber coming back at some point. Clevinger's a good starting pitcher as well. I mean, their pitching is clearly loaded. And what did they really lack that I've been saying all year long? They lack outfield bats. They don't have the bats out in the outfield. Oscar Mercado's been a great find for them. He's been a really good rookie, having a very solid season. He's definitely there to stay. But the other two positions are there up for grabs. And right now, you get to put Franmil Reyes either at the DH spot or in the corner outfield. You got Yasiel Puig, who you can stick in the outfield. Both guys who have 20-plus home runs this year, adding a ton of power to that lineup, making that lineup way more complete than it was in the past. Not to mention, you get Logan Allen, who's a nice arm. You got some prospects as well. I really, really like this move by the Cleveland Indians. That was a fantastic job by their front office. They improved their team a ton. They put a lot of pressure on the Twins right now, who really didn't make a lot of moves. They got Sergio Romo and Sam Dyson. Nice pickups for the bullpen, but when you look at what the Indians did, you go, ooh, It's going to be a battle at the end. There, of course, were a ton more trades that happened in the trade deadline that I am not going to cover in today's video. But like I said, tomorrow, I'm going to be doing my grades on all the trades, all the teams at the trade deadline. So if you want to see that, you know, click that sub button. You don't miss out on the content. Remember, leave a like on the video if you did enjoy it. That's the best way to show your support. Get in the comment section down below. Let me know your thoughts and opinions on the Puig trade, on the Zach Greinke trade, on any trade you want to down in the comments below. And you can also follow me on Twitter and Instagram at DraftNickMark. Links in the description to continue the conversation, as well as follow me because we're going to be giving away some stuff. And that's going to wrap up today's video. YouTube recommends you watch this video right here, as well as this is my most recent upload. So click through those if you have not yet seen them. Thank you guys for watching. The trade deadline was fantastic this year. It was a lull, and then it just got crazy hot. I really enjoyed streaming it today, so thank you to everyone who showed up for the stream. And I think it's time to end this video. Adios. Bye.